the governor recently announced the deficit in the state of Minnesota. And what's different about that is in February, March, when the legislature shut down, we had a surplus.
Yeah.
And so how much harder do you think it's going to be able to get your proposals through with the deficit now that we didn't have before?
I think that a lot of our budget picture as a state is really going to depend on what other sorts of funding may come in from the federal government, which I think really remains to be seen.
You're exactly right. And that was my thought. And that's my next worry is with all the damage that was recently done in Washington, D.C., and all the COVID action that needs to be taken swiftly for the disability issues, how fast will we get our federal money? How much will we get? How much will we cut back?
Today, my guest is Aaron Westendorp, who has worked as a DJ with KFAI and who has also been profiled in a documentary that will be premiering at a later date. So nice to see you, Aaron. Could you start with introducing yourself to our viewers?
Hey, nice to be here finally. And I promise I won't swear. Well, my name is Aaron, and I am known to be a nonverbal loudmouth. Let's just say my insult comedy is very well known. I am a radio DJ and producer. I write, produce, and host my own music show on KFAI 90.3 FM and KFAI.org. If you know Sam Jasmine's show, Disability and Progress, I am on the same station as that. I actually help Sam edit her show into podcast form as well. I am a percussionist with several local groups and a humanitarian who loves reaching out to others in a twisted way.
Aaron?
Yeah.
You mean other than as a small-time criminal?
He's always been very determined.
Describe him, not in a few words. I can't.
I guess my one word might be musical.
He's a prolific dancer.
A little dramatic.
Very goofy, yes.
Smart as hell.
Incredibly warm and also insulting.
He's one of the nicest guys I know.
Flirtatious.
Kind of grows on you.
Like foot fungus, yeah.
I think Aaron is exceptionally kind.
Sarcastic.
This killer sense of humor, this guy.
He's one of our prime characters here at KFAI.
I want you to meet Krista and Doug Westendorp. Your little boy was not born healthy. What was the problem?
Well, he was born with multiple neurologic handicaps.
The doctor said he wasn't going to live, and they said,
it's better for everyone if you just let him go.
We were advised not to take him home. It'll be the end of your family, the end of your marriage. He's not going to survive anyway.
And my parents were, I think, taking cues directly from Aaron and feeling like that's not what he wants. He wants us to fight for him.
Data showed that about 90% of the people that are dying from COVID thus far are over the age of 65. So that made sense, right? The purpose of the vaccine program is you're trying to prevent deaths. You're trying to prevent harm.
All right.
Well, the next stage was up the vaccine program to a broader group of people that included healthcare workers, it included childcare workers, it included teachers. So all of a sudden, we have hundreds of thousands of people that are getting the vaccine who are younger, who are healthier. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, we have a whole large population of people with significant developmental disabilities, mm-hmm. in some cases, serious health conditions that are being ignored. And that's kind of what we wrote about was, in a subset of that would be people with Down syndrome, where I didn't realize this until a couple weeks ago, mm-hmm. but people with Down syndrome are 10 times as likely to die from this virus than the general population. You know, they're 4 times as likely to be hospitalized mm-hmm. for a variety of reasons, but mostly they have weaker immune systems than the rest of us do.
The Metropolitan Center for Independent Living is always proud to guide people in the right way to connect to different resources to build in independence for as long as it's humanly possible.
Sounds great. How long have you been there now, Nick?
How long have I been with MCIO?
Yeah.
Oh, man. In August, Mark, it was 14 years, man.
Wow. 14 years of total entertainment.
I know. Total entertainment. That was before my beard.
Yeah, that sounds great. That sounds great. Well, my special guest today is Sean Gardner, and who he is, he's potentate for the Osmond Shrine in 2021. And Sean has given me a big honor this year. I myself happen to be chaplain of Osmond Shrine, which is a big promotion or honor for me within the Osmond Shrine.
So we believe that the Shriners Children's is the world's greatest philanthropy, and as Shriners, we covet together to support it, what we call these temples of mercy, with our time, talent, spirit, and means. And what that equates to is that we first try to raise funds to support the Shriners Children's. It's 22 different locations around the world, providing multiple types of care, among which is the pediatric orthopedics and burn care. We are the leaders in pediatric burn care.
Can you tell our viewers a little bit of background about Tree Trust?
So Tree Trust started in 1976 here in the Twin Cities. And at that time, we were facing two pressing problems. One is high unemployment, and the other was devastation of the tree canopy due to Dutch elm disease. And so our two founders recognized an opportunity, and that was to remove the dead elm trees and plant new trees, and all the while providing jobs to those in need. And so for 45 years, Tree Trust has continued to meet the ongoing needs of the community and helping promising young people build sustainable careers and inspiring people to plant trees for a resilient and healthy planet.
Awesome. I'm excited to have you tell our viewers a little bit more about the grant that you guys have over there. Would you be able to talk about how that grant got started?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, and just thank you, Nick. I mean, the Centers for Independent Living were at the forefront of really getting this grant and the design of the ramp that we use, which is a modular design, meaning that it can be built into components, it can be assembled in a shop and then taken out to the site and installed. And then what's really neat about it is it can be recycled. It can be reused as needed.
So with me today is Mary Kay Kennedy from Advocating Change Together, Daryl Paulson from Paulson & Companies, and Carrie Sheldon from the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities in St. Paul. Welcome, everyone, to the show. And I think we'll start out with Mary Kay Kennedy because she was a business partner of Rick's for a long time at Advocating Change Together. It's a very difficult time right now. It is for me, although I can't show it on the air or we wouldn't get anything done today. Rick and I spent a lot of time, as everybody did, down at the Senate and House and State Capitol, and Rick worked very, very hard. And a lot of the, as Daryl said before we went on the air, a lot of the things that we learned or grew up with in those circles, we learned from Rick. He was kind of a forefather in what we all do every day.
Well, you know, Mark, as you say, it's a sad time. And for sure, it's sad to see somebody we love so much go. But then at the same time, you know, Rick led such an interesting and full life. And he lived to be almost 80 years old. So when you think of him, you know, just like when he first was injured, they were saying, you know, you are not going to live a long life. So I think that he, you know, part of his journey in life was just every day was a gift. And he really, he did a lot. He enjoyed life. He loved people.
I did learn so much from Rick. And the one thing I can tell you is Rick and Mary Kay, both of you, have given Nikki and I a huge opportunity to be self-advocates and to be leaders in our community. And the reason I say that is because Mary Kay, I don't know if you remember this, but Rick and you gave Nikki and I opportunity to work for you guys. Right after you guys, we were getting ready to sign the contract. Rick was the first person that we told that Nikki was pregnant. So Allie, my daughter, who calls Rick Grandpa Rick, okay, she very much means that when she says that.
We never let Rick look at the vacation calendar too long, because every time he came by me, he said, Mark, take care of this for me, will you? Okay, Rick, I'm right on it, you know. So, I mean, he and that's the first lesson you got to learn in management is you delegate the responsibility.
Yep.
And
mm-hmm.
He just knew what he was going to do when, and I think we'll miss that. And like I've said before, and I'll repeat it again, he had the respect of all the legislatures there. And Nikki, one more thought before we go.
Just rest in power, Rick Cardenas. You know, I'll always remember nothing about us without us.
Very good. And thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints.
The good news is we've got two vaccines out there helping us trying to get rid of or at least slow down this pandemic. So that's, let's start with the good news. So we can say yay for that. So does the Department of Health here in Minnesota have some kind of plan just for people with disabilities besides your phase one and two that they have for the general public?
It's such a great question, Joan, and I wish I could tell you the exact answer. It just has been very stressful because, as you know, as we all know, there has been a limited number of vaccines available to all of us.
It's running smooth. It's good.
Overall, we've seen a lot of enthusiasm about the technology coming. This is kind of the preliminary phases to get the public involved and get our stakeholders engaged and really move this technology forward here in Minnesota.
Well, it's coming, and they're coming fast and furious. Yes, it's autonomous vehicles. They're coming to Minnesota. They're going to be such a huge impact for people with disabilities being able to live, work, and play, and just will be able to jump in one of those autonomous vehicles and get there independently. It's going to be fantastic.
When two souls meet and the whole world feels new, shared moments sweet, all colors bright and true, and there is laughter, and there are good things growing everywhere. And I'm happy to be in this place with you. And I'm happy to be in this place.
Yeah, it's really
so
cool.
So what other tricks can you do there, Fern?
Fernie, what else can you do? Can you show a park, maybe? Hi.
So we teach the dogs a lot of how to stay out of the way. So tucking themselves under a chair. Good. Very good. So our goal is kind of if you can leave a restaurant with a dog and the server goes, I didn't even know a dog was there.
How was canines affected during COVID? And did you place more dogs during COVID? How did that process work?
Well, interestingly, we were able to keep our operations going. We had a very, very lean staff on site working with the dogs and continued our client placement. So we ended up placing the same amount of teams that we had anticipated. So I'm pretty proud of our crew. We did a good job.
And how have some of those programs or resources changed during the pandemic?
Like many businesses, the pandemic has forced RISE and other providers to explore new ways of delivering services and supporting people. One of the new and creative service options that was developed early on during the pandemic involved the use of technology such as video chat to provide remote or virtual services. We started by helping people get set up and trained with the platforms that we were using, which were primarily Microsoft Teams and Zoom. And we also provided devices such as tablets for those people that didn't have access to that technology.
Tell us what ARC had to do and some of the new ways it handled the pandemic, if you will.
No, absolutely. I think, honestly, some of the way the pandemic happened is obviously a double-edged sword. So it made things more accessible in ways that they never were or that we did beyond what we could have imagined. But it also was just from a lobbying perspective, it was just a different way of lobbying rather than, you feel a little bit disconnected, you know, not being able to run into a legislator after a committee meeting or run into them in the hallway or just go to their office and try to catch them. But at the same time, it made it so that legislators had to actively reach out to us more. So, you know, we would maybe get more emails of legislators actively reaching out for input or feedback.
Honestly, COVID impacted everyone's mental health. It had a huge negative impact. And so I think that's something we need to keep in the forefront. And why was this? Well, first of all, we were living with great uncertainty. When this started back in March of 2020, we all thought it was going to be a month or two. And I think there was this general feeling like, we've got this, right? We can push through 2 months. We can make this work. And of course, by the end of April, beginning of May, we realized this was not a sprint, but this was a marathon. And it was a marathon of unknown miles.
With me today is Jacob Schuler, Executive Director of SimCell in the southeastern part of Minnesota toward the Mankato area. And he's my honored guest today, and he's here with me now. Jacob, explain a little bit about your organization and what SimCell stands for.
Thanks for having me today, Mark. I appreciate the opportunity to talk a little bit about Southeastern Minnesota Center for Independent Living. Just moving forward, I will use the acronym SimCell just to keep that simple because I know the full name is a bit of a mouthful. But we serve the 11 counties in Southeastern Minnesota. Our primary office is in Rochester, Minnesota, but we also have a satellite office in Winona, but we do provide services as far west as Freeborn, Steele, and Rice counties.
I'm Rob at SimCell. We're going to head out today, get ready to build a ramp. Final day on the job, getting her all done. Cody's up there finishing screwing some things off, and we'll wait for the inspector to show up, and hopefully we pass with flying colors.
Because they're using their own vehicle. It was a new standard right. for insurers, and they were carrying passengers. So unlike one of us using our vehicle to go to grocery store, if we were using our vehicle and being paid to have the trip and we had an accident, then there was higher liability for the insurance. So one of the key components this year that was adopted by the legislature was to state that if you are a volunteer driver only receiving reimbursement, you are not a for-hire carrier.
If somebody would like to be a driver here in the metro, the best place to go would be to Hands On Twin Cities, and that's handson.org. And they have listings of the main volunteer opportunities for driving.
Great.
With me today is my special guest, Jim Thayer. Jim is a name that's really synonymous with St. Paul. He's a retirement planner for the disabled. He was co-chair of the Mayor's Committee for People with Disabilities for years and years. And he was also head of the Spinal Bifida Board.
Still am.
And still am. He still is in St. Paul. So now it gives me a great pleasure to introduce to you my good friend and colleague, Jim Thayer.
Hi, Mark. Glad to be here.
Welcome to the show. Yeah. Welcome to the show. What is spina bifida?
Well, spina bifida, first and foremost, is a birth defect because there are a lot of people that actually are not sure about that. You know, they tend to think it's almost like COVID-19 that you can come down with it. But no, it's a birth defect. And here's the way I'll explain it because I had it explained to me by, I believe it was a doctor, because it was many years ago. But anyway, the word spina bifida is actually Latin, and I didn't take Latin in school, but anyway, it's Latin, and what it stands for is split or open spine.
Right.
And so the way it works is in the first part of pregnancy, the first month or two, the backbone actually grows around the spinal cord, and that's the neurotube, and it protects it. With spina bifida, it actually stops, and there's a hole.
Sweeping changes are coming to assisted living facilities in Minnesota, and they've started as of August 1st this year. Many issues have come about in the assisted living facility and licensure issues, and so today I brought with me Toby Pearson, Vice President of Care Providers Minnesota. So we've got a lot to talk about here today.
Yes, Joan, excited. Yes. It should be fun.
Right. Well, because people with disabilities and the seniors live in assisted livings. So what can you tell us about the whole idea of the licensure at assisted living facilities in Minnesota?
Well, it kind of started a couple of years ago. There was a number of press reports and other things that came out talking about the lack of kind of inspections and what was going on in assisted living. And so there are not group of advocates who came forward at the legislature and said, we need to do something. You know, before we moved into licensing assisted living, Minnesota had a housing with services type of model where an individual who was on a waiver would receive the services from a licensed provider. So MDH was licensing the provider to provide the services, but then they got to choose where they wanted to receive those services in a home-like setting. Which was then regulated kind of by the landlord-tenant, the local zoning ordinances, all that kind of stuff.
Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints from the State Fair Coliseum in Falcon Heights, Minnesota. With me today is Jim Berg, the number one magician in St. Paul. And he is a big part of the circus, and so he's going to talk to us about the Osmond Shrine Circus today. Welcome, Jim.
Thank you, Mark. Great to be here, or great to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you. I am a former patient of Shriners, and so this circus means a lot to me. And this is a big fundraiser for our organization. And so we hope everybody joins us and comes on down and enjoys it. Can you tell us a little bit about what's going on, Jim?
Well, we've got a fabulous show lined up. This is an all-new show with lots of fun activities for children of all ages. And we've got everything from the traditional circus clowns, which are our own Osmond clowns from St. Paul. And then we've got animals, we've got camels, we've got elephants, the largest act in the circus, jugglers, and all kinds of fun superhero acts. You're gonna have fun.
Great, how many years has the Shrine Circus been around?
The Shrine Circus itself began in 1906. That was the first circus held in Detroit, Michigan. However, the Osmond Shrine Circus in St. Paul is the longest continuous run circus. This is our 97th year. Wow. No one has run circus as long as we have.
We have a shuttle that runs around the city and a multiple block area. And we're piloting it for MnDOT and the U to see how it works.
Cool. So what's the perception? What are the Rochester citizens saying? Yay, we want one of these, or oh my goodness, get that thing out of here.
I would say, reviews are mixed. I think there are a lot of people that see the possibilities that this type of vehicle could have. You asked earlier about, is it handicap accessible? Is it wheelchair accessible? And of course it is.
Yay.
And that makes it, and that makes it very interesting to people, you know, utilizing wheelchairs and walkers and strollers. The ease there, but also because we're home to Mayo Clinic, we have many, many patients that come to visit and that live in the area that particularly the visitors often don't have a car with them, particularly if they're staying for an extended period of time. So the possibilities for, you know, folks with disabilities are huge. People in the community like the idea. It's creative. Mm-hmm. The downside, I will tell you, however, is it's too slow, says the driver of the car behind it.
And most people, when they think of connected and automated vehicles, are actually thinking of self-driving or driverless vehicles. But connected and automated vehicles is so much more than just that. So I like to separate them between the two. We have connected and automated. And connected vehicles really use technology to communicate to each other, to other things, to traffic signals, to signs, and they can obtain data from other sources as well. This really helps allow for some enhanced safety as well as potentially improving traffic flow. And then we get to the automated side, and that's where we can use technology to do different types of operations of a vehicle, like steering, accelerating, or braking, and that can have varying levels of human input.
Great. So thanks so much.
For Joan Wilshire and the entire team here at SPNN, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. We'll be back soon. Bye now.